It's always exciting when we can call someone up here for the first time. I got to hear him read at the at Tony's Tavern, which is a reading you should all know about. I believe that's the first Monday, is that correct? First Monday of the month at Tony's Tavern on Burnside in Portland. And he's a new transplant to the area, or new-ish. And so let's give him a warm Ghost Town Poetry open mic welcome. Say hello to Ulrich Cowley.
Thank you very much. Thank you for hosting this and putting it on. It's a beautiful thing. I'm actually from Birmingham, Alabama. And I want to say that because I understand that y'all have a thing about, or you can see the South in a variety of different ways. And I'm here to hopefully blow all those kind of preconceived notions out of the water, you know?
You are the new South.
The new South, exactly. That's what I'm telling you. We're coming up, y'all.
I'm from Georgia. We got it.
Yeah. Until then, we're just going to keep coming up here and just showing y'all how.
Yes. Great.
But because of the nature of tomorrow, I decided to read this poem that I wrote a couple years ago called What is a Nation? Start. What is a nation but a system of oppression? As Proudhon once said, all property is theft. How did we acquire such vast lands? Who had the audacity to sign their name on the lease of the powerful Mississippi? Oh, great America, how is it that you acquired such capital? Whose backs broke? Who filled your minds with their bodies? Whose tears watered the fields for you? Where are your answers? Why are our heroes more often than not but just oppressors who have created vast sums of wealth through the subjugation of labor? Why is it that our history is so slanted? I'm from the deep South. A statue of Robert E. Lee and a rebel flag are the physical facts of my indoctrination. But you see, this is a new South, so I say this land has been decimated for capital. This land where everything has a price tag, ideologies to suppress, entertainment to distract, countless cries of the past are silenced by the volume button. Ignorance glamorized, celebrated, and merchandised for mass consumption. Criminals parading for the citizens' enjoyment. Is this discipline? What is a nation but an ideology to control the community and to silence the individual? Oh, chaos, impenetrable daemon swelling up and down through us around like a ship on a sick sea, our own waste drowning us. If we could stop confusing the ship for the sea, chaos is just the lack of knowledge of our history. Knowledge is the liberation from that all-consuming chaos, that absurd mistress of experience. No blind faith in any ideology will save you from the savage sea of chaos. You must embrace that dissonance to see between the categorizations that have been created and perpetuated throughout history. It's no mystery. It has been at the forefront of our psyche since the written word began. Where the prophets write, will capitalism eat itself, or will the consolidation of power continue and continue to leave the powerless opened and exposed to the ramifications of the pursuit of capital, the forgotten, left to etch their lives out in an uncharted world. It is said, God is dead, but instead, he did a fuck and flee, leaving us with an STD called consciousness. We have created a culture around the worship of a new deity. Unconsciously, we say our prayers to our great God, capital. If property is theft, then who owned it originally? Is ownership of billions of years of worth of adaptation and mutation even a tenable thing? Do we really believe our species to be some ordained organism when we have lied waste to our great garden 250,000 years later, and our biggest achievement is an illusion that consumes whoever and whatever for its own ends? We will devour ourselves. We are Ouroboros eating its own tail. Capital the beast with its mighty wings, the monster who has set the world ablaze with its thrashing talons desecrating our garden. Amongst the countless deaths, modernity awoke us, just to send us through the gates of anxiety. And there we will still remain, stuck in the funhouse with the mirrored walls. We produce pills to calm our fractured egos, to bring us closer to acceptance, to quell the absurdity that rings out inside our being. In the death throes of capitalism, something new is arising from the womb of Earth. Is it the final destroyer come to finish the conquest of capital? Or is it something creative, energetic, adaptive, healing come to our garden that we have so foolishly poisoned? All around you see the unconscious hope to return to the Eden. Ever since the Enlightenment, you have seen it bleed through our art, our philosophies, our cries of liberation, but still we remain locked out by the symbol, confused by the metaphor. We've carried it from its birth. Through our language, it has now germinated. It has now bore fruit. It has matured. Everywhere, it has matured. Everywhere, it rears its head. All ideologies are born from it. All faiths. The cosmic serpent delivered us in its canoes. It has been with us since that moment we have arisen from the primordial darkness of evolution. It has made its home amongst our thoughts. Even now, the earth is in turmoil, shaking and aware of its coming. It has delivered us as we, through our splintered collective unconsciousness, will deliver it. Will it stand a chance against the flaming eagle of capital? Fangs and talons will be the vessels of the deciders of our fate. Thank you.
So I'm surely a New York chauvinist, so I don't know from the New South, but I do have family down there near Birmingham, so big shout out to the Washingtons in Alabama, and it's pretty much a comedy show when, you know, the folks from New York go down to visit the folks in Alabama, because we're speaking really fast, they're speaking really slow or slower than us, and so we all love each other very much, but there's a lot of kind of like nodding and pretending that we got the last bit, you know?
Or that you know what you're eating.
Yeah, I'm looking for that. But you know, the one thing that I can say is absolutely true what they, my cousins are African-American, and it's true what they say about the Southern hospitality, because we went into what was essentially an all black neighborhood except for my aunt, and were treated like family, and they'd never seen us before, you know what I mean? So yeah, that was a beautiful thing. Yeah. Thank you, Ulrich, for coming. I hope that you'll come again. We're glad to have you be a part of tonight's festivities. And now we have the person that's been making sure that we are on the interwebs for all eternity this evening, and a good friend of ours, Bryce Tran. Come on up, Bryce.
Hey, can I take a picture of you? You've been taking pictures of all of us.
Yeah. He's the classic.
It's falling apart.
That's all right. That's a sweet guitar.
Yes. That's my newest one. Got it on like, I think it was like 26 degrees outside. I walked all the way to Briz, then walked all the way back to the school. I couldn't feel my fingers afterwards. I was playing it for the people. That's and this strap is going to give me hazards. That's okay. Okay. Let's see if I can play this. So, let's see here. Alright. So I've been really into like doing simple songs and stuff, and all about like simplicity and stuff, because it's like simplicity is very underrated, you know. I mean, like
the less complex something is, the more inviting it is, you know. And so this song is one that I'm working on. All of my stuff is work in progress, and it's called Walking Blind. It's my kids in tune and I'm so in tune.
Pretty good.
What did I say? Even dead people have the blues. Even dead people have the blues. Even dead people have the blues. Whole lot of nothing and nothing to lose. Bring your books. Bring your shoes. Whole lot of nothing and nothing to lose. Brillo cream. Morning. 10 cigarettes smoked before work. Hacking. Are you sorry you did it? Or sorry you got caught? Heroin is hell on earth. Even dead people have the blues. Whole lot of nothing and nothing to lose. Bring your books. Bring your shoes. Whole lot of nothing and nothing to lose. Yeah. Now we're going to try and channel William Burroughs doing Jim Morrison. Lions in the street and roaming, dogs in heat, rabbit foaming. A beast caged in the heart of the city. The body of his mother rotting in the summer ground, he fled the town. Left the chaos and disorder back there over his shoulder. One morning he awoke in a green hotel with a strange creature groaning beside him. Is everybody in? Is everybody in? The ceremony is about to begin. Wake up. You can't remember where it was. Has this dream stopped? I let my cheek slide down the cold, smooth tile. Feel the cold, smooth, hissing blood. The smooth snakes of rain. No night arrives with its purple legion. Retire now to your tents and to your dreams. Tomorrow we enter the town of my birth. I want to be ready. We have Tracy. Come on down, Tracy. There are enough empty beers on that table that this should be pretty fucking good.
Well, I have to say that. Oh, that's great.
Sorry.
You're good.
There you
go. I'm understood. I want to thank Chris for the other night. Well, Sunday, we had a good show of all the great people amongst us who we're going to be on the bus stream going from here to south and back again. This is the one that I didn't get on there, I guess, but I didn't think about it then. It's Mother's Child. Streetwise older woman pushing grocery carts full of their life around the downtown blocks they own. Sheltered from inclement weather by bus stop awnings. Waiting for the bus stop, they never board. They pass out of sight of the passengers traveling to the next stop. They pass out of sight of their sons and daughters, known only to police and emergency room staffers, their unspoken history written across forehead furrows. Didn't think that one would get up in there.
Yeah, man.
Here's one my friend said I should never say, but I met my wife in our college dreams. It's never really what it seems. You make plans for tomorrow, and it's the future that you borrow. Took a job that took me out of town. That's why that pool boy kept coming around. Cleanest pool that was ever found. But without that boy, my wife would drown, and all her memories. So another one of my favorite poets, I don't think has been here before. Have you read here before? I'm not sure.
Building.
Huh?
Building.
At the other place, yeah. So let's welcome back Pico's Jet. Really like to hear his stuff.
Ecclesiastes abridged. All is vanity, saith the preacher. It's a wind-wind situation. Suicide, the path of least existence. Suicide notes are letters of resignation. Note to self, stop writing about suicide so much. Suicide note to self, bang, you're dead. Nights like these are lonely like coffins must be, outside just a memory. Desire, licking the edge of the knife and swallowing blood will not quench your thirst. Proletariat pines for the finer things. Elite enlists PR firm to ensure the finer things are consistently defined as the things they have, lest people wake up and value people again. Social worker, professional listener, shouldn't everyone be good at that by now? Why dost thou, Confucius, me so? Kiss me, Krishna, on my godhead. Dinner me some top Brahmin. Prince, are you gonna eat that? Jesus Christ, save me from your followers who would become your executioners. JC, I love you, but save me from modern Pharisee who parades around in hypocrisy in your name. Hotai, oh my, I see Buddha chubby laughing face, laughing at my desires, my pain, my ego, because we go. Worldly passings pass, materials dematerialize before your capital eyes. Jehovah and Ova again. Allah, the time wondering which Yahweh do I go from here? The prophecy of the Hopi says there's no Hopi to Apache the holes in our lives out of balance. But all that's just nomenclature. The name for the naming of names. Shakespeare asked, what's in a name? I don't know, Bill. Big Willie. What is it? Sometimes I feel like King Lear's fool, wiser than the king, but still known as a fool. I can't help you, Nuncle. I'm just accepting there's no exception to the rule that everybody plays a fool sometimes.
So, if you're not going to the Women's March on Saturday, I'll be doing my monthly workshop next door at Niche, which we have postponed for a week because of the weather. At least one person mentioned that she would be heading there, and I told her that's where you should be. I'll see you again next month. But if you're not doing that, come on by. We start at 11:30, we go till about 2:30. What I like to do is make sure that we do at least four exercises in that time, because I know as a workshop participant, I felt at times like I didn't really get a lot of writing done at certain workshops, so I just try to make sure that a person leaves with three or four beginnings for pieces before they go, and we have a good time. The bar's not open at 11:30, but Leah comes in and opens the place, and we'll make tea and coffee, and people bring snacks to share because of the hour, and also bring a poem to share to say hello. That's usually how we start that workshop, is everybody, we go around the circle and we hear a little bit from everybody who's there. And then the last announcement for tonight is, I guess it's two, but they're quick. One is National Unpublished Writers Day, an event that I inherited from WSUV Professor John Barber, who is the one of the people who knows the most about Richard Brautigan in the country and brought the Brautigan Library here to the Clark County Historical Museum. He passed the event on to me, and it's basically an event that is for people who are just trying to figure out this whole thing of how to get your work out into the world. So we're going to have some great people there, like Penelope Scanlon-Schott, Nancy Flynn, Anatoly Molokov, who am I forgetting? There's probably a couple other people. There'll be tables with information, and you know, it's basically a way to meet other writers and get some information about how to get your stuff out into the world. And it's always on the last Sunday of January, because we try to get it as close to Richard Brautigan's birthday as we can every year, and it's at the library, at the Vancouver Community Library. So, January 29th, the day after Ian's book launch. If you want to join us over there at the library, 1 to 5. And it's the kind of thing where there'll be a new presentation or something going on every hour, but you're also welcome to sort of like, you know, stop by for a little while and wander off. You know, it's that kind of a thing.
And it's free.
It is free, yes. Important for the poets to know that it's free. This is a new poem called Poetic Sigil Against the Spirit Death of the Psychonaut. Catholic school sense memory, the constant purgatory of fear. Below and beyond the honeycomb tile, the solidity of the world recedes. I am safe for as long as this strange vision holds. Later, ego death, the twirling of the leaf and the sudden separation of the greens. Doors of perception remain open for the duration. I cannot prove that either of us is here or that any of this is real. Certain that I can't tell you what any of it means. But I know that my love created you because I was there at the moment that you slipped screaming into this world. And then this is something that the people that came to that Tony's reading heard, and I want to just say thank you to Dennis McBride, who's really somebody that I really respect and admire for just the kind words that he said about this. And you know, I'm reading it again because it's one of these poems that it's like a combination of my own words and things that I've borrowed, but I'm trying to arrange them so that they'll say something that I need to say. And this is for my fellow poets. It's called Welcome to Life, Motherfucker.
Yeah.
Appalled by the enormity of my self-regard, there's got to be more to this tradition of transmission than elitism and intellectual circle jerk. the tyranny of intentionality, visions of glamorous hell with bags full of havoc. Like Bobby and Joni walking the festival grounds, cracking a bullwhip, superstars in our thinking, where you swim, she drowns. The whole impossibility of actually seeing something. I think that now that's a very difficult process to navigate. There's so much to cut through. It's a very complicated terrain. The solid marrying the liquid, that curious lurking something, it's up to us to find their breath in the fog. To quietly float is a huge challenge. To get people to use their eyes and to get them to notice the things they don't pay attention to. Everybody does look, it's just a question of how hard. Williams modeled brevity and precision. Duncan invited us to return to the field. Ginsberg recommended candor. Nikki reminded us to stand up. I am constantly voraciously reading medical texts until 4 or 5 in the morning. I want more energy, I want more vitality, I want more hair. I want to snuff around and eavesdrop on people. I want to go further, transcending time. Life breaks all of us. Capitalism enters our central nervous system and gives us many levels of sickness. The antidote, spermy poetic language, explosive and ejaculatory, a new way to communicate, to participate, a new spiritual condition. If you're open to infinity, you have a chance to regenerate yourself. And once all these circles, these circular temples regenerate themselves, they're the same old world, but with a fresh new morning exhalation. I'll always be your friend, and even your poet laureate. I'm not a revolutionary, yet I feel I have something of value to say. I do overshare. It's my way of trying to understand myself. It creates community when you talk about private things. It's sort of a hobby of mine, the truth. The truth is not needed, but something is. I have spent eons sitting here, right here. I have been to hell and back, and let me tell you, it was wonderful. One moment equals eternity. That tranquility is right at the edge of chaos. Words are sigils for the unutterable, incomprehensible, ineffable energy coursing through all life forms, poetic pictograms, guttural grunts toward meaning, phenomenological symbology, grand, and finally, inadequate. Welcome to life, motherfucker. So, you know, one of the things that's beautiful about the open mic is that you don't have control. I mean, it's like a 12, 13, however many years it's been, experiment in anarchy, and that's the way I like it. That's not the way all open mics are. That's the way this one's been. Before it had a title, we had the tagline, All Ages and Uncensored, so we knew that much was going to happen, right? And later on, even though some people think it's weird, LGBTQ-friendly, right? I had people in the community came up and said things to me like, why do you need to advertise that? Well, I said, well, you know what? We've proven that it's been true for many years now, and I want the people out there who might be wondering whether it's friendly or not to know that this place is safe. And it's, you know, I expected, as much as anybody else might have, that somewhere along the line, one of our trans friends that comes to the reading or one of our queer friends that comes to the reading might have come across some bad vibes, at least, and we haven't had any of them since 2004. So, yeah. So we need to create the safe spaces and say the things that need to be said and get pissed and fumble at it and not always be perfect at it, but you know, I think that the poets can be, if they should choose to accept this, right? We can be sort of like on the front lines of this resistance that's gonna have to happen. And the truth is that we already are, we already were. It's just that now the shit's gotten real, right? So keep doing what you've been doing and it'll be all right. So when Tony and I talk things over, so you can't control anything, but we do talk a little bit about the features and sort of the flow of the evening, and then once we see who's signed up, we will sometimes try to make some little adjustments, or even the decision about who the last person is gonna be before the feature is a big deal to us. We really try to put a lot of thought and attention into that and have it make sense in some way, and also try to make it so that the person, you know, just make sure that it makes sense as a show once it starts happening. And so I thought, well, the best closer that I've ever seen, like in the whole world, the best one at ending an evening is Mike. So we have to have Mike do his feature at the end. But then Tony was like, well, some people have to leave in the middle and some people don't make it to the end. It's a long night, it always has been. So let's put him at the beginning. And we did that and I thought it worked out really well. But because we did that, our friend Picos, who like all of you, is a big fan of Mike G. Didn't get to hear Mike G do anything. So I asked Mike if he would come up and read one more poem because he is the closer, he is the king, and he's the one who should have the last word tonight.
Poet
so,
of Steel.
Poet of Steel, Mike G.
What a beautiful time. Thanks, everybody. Let's try to go forth with courage as we defy in our own ways what's coming. I hope you all like Jane Goodall. I worry about her because she's never had a relationship with a human.
It has come to my attention that Jane Goodall believes in the existence of Sasquatch. Why, Jane? Because I'm a romantic, she says. I'm leaving the chimps behind. They no longer satisfy. My entire life I've wanted to mate with an undiscovered great ape. I want to discover the hairy root of his genius. Be a wife to a non-human husband. Wife to a primate, Mr. Wright. I love Jane Goodall. I want her dream to come true. I picture her in a forest clearing, naked on hands and knees, rump thrust to the stars. Her vagina shines silver-haired in lusty moonlight. Her vagina smeared with the pheromones of ovulating silverbacks and chimpanzees. I picture Jane Goodall howling for her Sasquatch to come, and he comes. He howls. She howls. He rips through trees to get to her. Her once kind eyes, now ferocious in lust, fixed to his cock, hard and fur shrouded, balls dragging the ground, plowing the earth to greet her, and her face, beautiful wild animal face. Jane's face is now identical to her face as it was before she was born, and a joyful tear drips from her clit. She lives out her days in pure beast happiness. She grows back the fangs, claws, fur she had before. At midnight they swim in the secret lake. Holding hands they float on their backs. Jane Goodall smiles. Sasquatch smiles. He scoops her body onto his. His gentle eyes commune with the gentleness in hers. They kiss and kiss as the moon sets and the forest roars, moans, cries, hoots, chirps, sings the same ecstatic, tragic song it always sings, always will, and for the rest of her life, in the arms of Sasquatch, Jane sleeps well. Thanks.
Thank you, Mike. All right, everybody, the next reading is going to be on February 9. We're going to have some friends from Eugene. They host the Poetry for the People reading at Tsunami Books down there, Roy Seitz and Laura LaHue, so come back for that. And let's give it up one more time for Mike G and Jen Coleman. All right, see you in February. Have a good night. Be safe out there.